Well, I am, to use the word excited would be an understatement. Folks, you got to understand something now. I've made mistakes in my life, and I don't claim to have not. I made some mistakes. I even went away from the Lord for a time in my life, which was quite possibly the dumbest thing I could have ever done. But I did it, and that's how it was. But you got to understand something. I was born again when I was 8 years old. So that was 41 years ago. I've been in and around church my whole life. All I've ever known, I've worked other jobs, but my point is I've always known ministry. I mean, it was commonplace in my family to see healings and miracles and demons being cast out. I mean, I remember being 3 or 4 years old and seeing people get delivered from demon spirits. I mean, people getting healed. People that the doctor said there was absolutely no way they could live, but they lived because God healed them. I remember a man that stayed with us, and his name was Ronald Coyne, and he was a very dear friend of my father's. Now, Ronald Coyne was, they called him the plastic eye miracle. And the reason for that, when he was a young boy in Sepulpa, Oklahoma, him and his brother were playing in the yard there where they lived. And his brother was playing with a piece of baling wire, and he was swinging it around, and he jabbed it in his eye. And, of course, the eye just got really bad, so they took him to the doctor, and the doctor said, there's nothing we can do. We got to remove the eye. So they removed the eye. Well, he was a younger boy then, and he got up into his teenage years, and they took him to a meeting where Sister Daisy Gillock was ministering. Daisy Gillock was the sister of Dr. T.L. Osmer, and she was having a meeting there in Oklahoma. And Ronald Coyne, Brother Ronnie, he had a chest cold. And so he went up to get prayer for that cold. Well, she prayed for the cold, but she looked at his eye and she thought he was blind in that eye. So she also prayed and said, Lord, give him sight in his eye. She didn't know there wasn't an eye. Lord, give him sight in that eye. And so it was just a very short period of time. I mean, a matter of hours after that, he started seeing out of that eye. But he didn't have an eyeball. I can remember being just five or six years old, and he was a very dear friend of our family up to the day he died. And he would come stay with our family and sit, and my dad and him, they would talk about the things of the Lord. And I was just so intrigued because they would take a handkerchief like this handkerchief, and fold it 6 times. And they would place it over that eyeball. They would fold it no way you could see through it. And he would take a whole roll of medical tape, an entire roll of medical tape, and tape that eye completely shut, his good eye, tape it completely shut. And then he would pop out that plastic eye, actually glass, but plastic eye, glass eye. And people would bring him Bibles, Social Security cards, driver's license, and he would read them without an eyeball. No eye, and he would read them. Perfect vision without an eyeball. You understand? Now, I'm saying all that to say that's what I was raised in and around. I can remember times of the anointing, being a kid, where the anointing, the power of God would just flow into that service. And I don't want to use the word afraid, because God's presence never makes you afraid. It makes you aware of how great God is and how little you are, but it doesn't make you afraid. I can remember being a kid and just enjoying the presence of God and just seeing people get healed and set free and delivered by the power of God. I mean, my own father, his testimony, he was given up for dead when he was born. He did die when he was born. He was dead, and they laid him on a gurney and covered him with a sheet and put him over in the hallway because they were trying to do some work on my grandmother. But my great-grandmother, who was, now, y'all got to understand, we have Baptists around here, but she was what you called hard-shell Southern Baptist, all right? I mean, the Baptists thought she was Baptist, amen? She heard about what had happened, and she come up in that hospital, Southern Baptist, and laid hands on my dad and commanded life to come back into him. And God restored him. Well, the doctor said he'll never be right. He was born. I don't know the exact cause of the infirmity. It's believed it was polio, but he was born. His right shoulder was 3.5 inches lower than his left shoulder. His right hand was completely turned around backwards. The knuckles were on the back of his hand instead of on the front of his hand. He couldn't walk. He drug his right side. Bone deformities in his right side of his body. Braces from his shoulder to his ankle. Tumor on the brain. Severe heart condition. And the doctor said if he lives to be 13, it'll be a miracle. There's no way he can live past that. There's too much wrong with him. But my uncle Chester, who was a Southern Baptist preacher, heard about a meeting where Dr. Elsie Roby, Lyman Charles Roby, he was one of the great healing evangelists of the Voice of Healing days that ran from 1948 to 1957, something along those lines. He was ministering at the Glad Tidings Assembly of God at 103rd and Euclid Avenue in Cleveland, Tennessee. Pastor Claude Bowman was the pastor there. And he said, he came to my father's house and he told my grandmother, Margaret, he said, Margaret, he said, there's a preacher down here that's saying God still heals. And he said, let me take Bud, that's what they called him, and let's just see what God will do for him. Let's just see if God will do anything. You know, if he doesn't do anything, we haven't lost anything. So they took him home, bought him new clothes, took him to the church that night. Amen. And he said he went in that room and there was hundreds. You know, it was a big church for the day. Hundreds of Pentecostals in there. And he said he came in the aisle. You know, he's a Southern Baptist boy, never been in a Pentecostal church. And he heard these ladies over to his right speaking in tongues. And he thought, boy, that's beautiful. I'd love to learn to do that someday. And my great uncle Jack was with him. My great uncle Jack served honorably in World War II. He's one of the greatest generation. And he was a sailor, a Navy man. And he came there with my dad that night. And he was a big man. All of my father's uncles were big guys, real broad-shouldered, big guys. But they sat down in the chair. They had theater-type seats. And they sat down in the chair. And Dr. Roby came out and preached. And he just preached a salvation message. God loves you. Jesus died for your sins. Now, I'm building to a point. I'm not going to be before you long tonight. God loves you. Jesus died for your sins. Short message. Who wants to be born again tonight? And my father said, at 13 years of age, for the very first time, I realized I was lost. I was without God. And I wanted to get up and go to the altar, but I couldn't get up by myself. He said, my Uncle Jack looked over there and saw me struggling to get up. And he said, do you want to go down there? He said, yes, I want to go down there. He reached around and picked him up. And my Uncle Jack wasn't saved. About halfway down the aisle, conviction came on my Uncle Jack, and they both got saved. Hallelujah. I'll never forget my father saying, he said, you know, at that moment, I'm born again. He said, I didn't care about the tumor. I didn't care about the heart condition. I didn't care about the deformities or the problems that I had. I knew I was born again. Amen. Well, there were miracles that preceded that. A woman brought her baby that had a club foot. The right foot was completely turned around backwards. Dr. Roby prayed for that baby. He said, Father, in the name of Jesus, thank you for healing this child. For your glory, heal this child. And in front of all those hundreds, possibly thousands of people, that little foot just spun around. I mean, nobody touched it. Nobody moved it. It just popped around. Amen. And that mama had a brown bag under her arm. And she began to shout and say, I knew it. I knew it. I knew it. And she pulled a brand new pair of shoes out of that bag. Say, I bought my baby new shoes tonight because I knew God was going to heal him. They brought a school teacher up that had been in an automobile accident. She was paralyzed from her neck down. She was completely in braces. You know, in those days, that's all they knew to do was put you in braces and hope it got better. He prayed for her. Very simple prayer. Father, for your glory, heal this woman in Jesus' name. They wheeled her in the back. And my dad said he was sitting on the front. He said it seemed like it took forever. And the enemy was saying, yeah, she's fallen back there and you're not going to get healed because she didn't really get healed. He said, but in a moment, the curtains opened up and the wheelchair came out and in the wheelchair was the braces and behind the wheelchair was the woman pushing the wheelchair full of braces. He said, my God, there wasn't anything at that moment that I didn't believe God could do. Amen. And then he said, it came my turn. Hallelujah. And Dr. Roby came to him and said, "Son, do you believe Jesus will heal you?" He said, "I believe it." And he said that same prayer, "Father, for your glory, heal this young man." And he said, the first thing that happened, it felt like warm oil hit on the top of my head. And he said, I felt like somebody was massaging that tumor on the inside of my brain. And he said, all of a sudden, the pressure just went away. It just went away. He said, the constant aching in my chest just stopped. Because it felt like a hand reached in my chest and just gave me a new heart. His shoulder just popped up. The braces began to hurt. Because he didn't have any muscles. He didn't have anything in his legs. And the braces began to hurt. He took the braces off. 13 years of age and had never walked a normal step in his life. But at 13 years of age, he's running and jumping. Amen. I have the original clipping from the Voice of Healing magazine that documents my father's miracle. And it shows him at 13 years of age standing there with his right hand lifted up that he never could lift up. But there he is lifting it up. He was walking out of that. He was walking out of that church service that night. A year earlier, they had brought him home on the special education bus that he rode to school on. And the driver would, of course, he couldn't walk. So the driver would hand him to my grandfather. And he said, my grandfather was carrying me into the house. And he said, I heard a voice that said, you're going to preach the gospel around the United States and in foreign nations. And he said, I remember thinking, how can I preach the gospel? I can't even walk. And as he was walking out of that Glad Tidings Assembly of God, the Holy Spirit spoke to him and said, this is how you're going to preach the gospel. Now, I'm saying all that to say, I have a heritage of great things, powerful moments. Now, I said all that to say this, but yet I have never experienced the presence of God like we're experiencing it now. I've never seen God doing more than he's doing right now. In your lives, I've never seen it. And I've seen wonderful things. I've seen mass meetings where people were healed and set free. I was sitting in Taos, New Mexico at a meeting one time, and we had brought a young lady with us from our church that was stone deaf, stone deaf. We had known this young girl for years. She had never been able to hear, never been able to hear, could not hear at all, not even a little bit of hearing. And sitting in that meeting in Taos, New Mexico, nobody laid hands on her. No, nobody spoke over her. She's just sitting there in that meeting where the anointing is flowing, and all of a sudden begin to grab her ears and look around like, what is going on? She could hear. She could hear perfectly that quickly. You understand? But yet, I've never seen God moving on a level like he's moving now. I'm saying that to tell you, in this year that we're living in, this is the year of the impossible. Amen. And it started with restoration. And we've spent several weeks talking about restoration. What does that look like? I want to start tonight. We're going to stay with the same theme, restored to wholeness. But we're going to begin to look and ask this question. What does recompense look like? He said it would be restoration, recompense, and release. Hallelujah. You never want to look back at what used to be and talk about it as being greater than what you're moving into. What people do is they don't receive all of God's best because they think the best is behind them. It's not. It's right now. Nobody in this building was born at the wrong time. Nobody was born too late. Nobody was born too early. You should not have been born in the early 1900s. There are people say, oh, wouldn't that have been a great time? Maybe, but I wasn't supposed to be born then. I was supposed to be born for right now. You've got to understand, God has handed you and I as a fellowship and as a church. He has handed us a baton, and he's asking us to run this race that he set before us. And it doesn't matter who gets the glory. It doesn't matter who gets the credit. It does not matter when I pass this baton off that I carried it. It just matters that it keeps going. We're living in the greatest time that's ever been. Not just as a church universally. This is the greatest time of your Christian life. Why? Because God is promising us more things than ever before. Every week, something supernatural happens in this church. Every week, somebody gets something they weren't supposed to get. Somebody's healed of something they weren't supposed to get healed of. Amen. Somebody's son or daughter gets delivered. It looked hopeless. It looked impossible. But God met them and set them free. No more waiting. Get ready to swim. That's wading. W-A-D-I-N-G. No more waiting. Get ready to swim. That's what he said. Remember? He said, by summer, I need you big. No more waiting. Get ready to swim. Where does he need us big? Right here. In what we're thinking. So we want to look at, what does recompense look like? Look at Proverbs chapter 11, verse 31. Am I helping you tonight? Yeah. Hallelujah. As good as it has ever been, it can be better than it's ever been. But you don't want to stop at better than it's ever been. You want to move in to as good as God wants it to be. Notice what Proverbs chapter 11, verse 31 says. It talks about the righteous. And it says, the righteous shall be recompensed in the earth, much more the wicked and the sinner. Now, this is where we'll begin to get our picture of recompense. He says, the righteous, say, that's me, shall be recompensed in the earth. This word recompense comes from the Hebrew word shalom, S-H-A-L-A-M. Now, it's akin to the word shalem, where we get nothing missing, nothing broken. It comes from the word mashalem, which comes from the word shalom. It means peace, nothing missing, nothing broken. Now, this is a derivative of that, and it means to reciprocate, to give again, to repay, or to make prosperous. To reciprocate, to give again, to repay, or to make prosperous. So the righteous, God will give to them again. God will repay them. God will make them prosperous. This is the beginning of what recompense looks like. He said to us that 2016 would be the year of the payoff, a year when recompense will flow. Now we're getting an idea then of what is recompense. Recompense is repayment. Recompense is reciprocation. And he said we would be recompensed, notice, for all the times you stood and it appeared the result was loss. Now, no matter who you are or how long or short you've been serving God, there have been times that you have stood and it appeared that the result was loss. Most of the time, people say it this way. Well, I did what the preacher said, and it didn't work. No, it just appeared that way. Is God true to His word? Yes. Then that means I cannot do anything according to the word of God that God does not intend to do what He promised me. Do you see that? No matter what challenge you face, you never allow it to turn you bitter against the Word. You don't allow your circumstances to turn you away from the Word. No matter how bad the circumstance is, you've always got to turn back to the Word, because the Word is the answer. I said it this morning, the Word is always the answer. It's never the problem, and it's never wrong. It's always the answer. So there are times that people have stood and it appeared the result was lost. And then he defined it. It'll be recompense for that which was stolen by the enemy, or even taken or lost through ignorance, through a lack of understanding. So there are things the enemy stole. Those may even be, listen, you're probably going to get recompense this year for some things that you didn't even know were taken, because it was stolen. That means something was coming into your life that was taken. You may not have even known it's coming. But God keeps a record of it. God is a perfect bookkeeper, and He knows everything He intends for it to be in your life. And if anything is stolen, He marks that down, because He's just and He intends to recompense you for it. Hallelujah. Glory to God. All those years I lost with my family, recompense is coming. Payback. Reciprocation. Amen. So what does recompense look like? Well, Romans chapter 12, verse 17. Let's look here. Now, I will share this with you. When you look at recompense throughout the Word of God, especially in the Old Testament, every reference, almost every reference, I should say, there are a couple, almost every reference has to do with a negative connotation towards the person being recompensed, because it's usually used in connection with the sinner getting recompensed for their evil. But it still gives us an idea of what recompense looks like. Amen. Romans 12, verse 17. Notice what it says. Hallelujah. Recompense to no man evil for evil. Provide things honest in the sight of all men. That word recompense, it means to give back, to give again, or repay. To give back, to give again, or repay. The Amplified Bible says, repay no one evil for evil. Now, that's not what I'm preaching on. I'm teaching for us to get an idea of what recompense looks like. Repay no one evil for evil. So recompense is to give back, to give again, or repay. The CEB translation says, don't pay back anyone for their evil actions with evil actions. So here we get the idea of payback. Recompense is to pay back. Well, God called it this year payoff. It's the year of the payoff, the year when recompense will flow. Hallelujah. Don't pay back anyone for their evil actions with evil actions. So recompense then carries the idea of repayment. It carries the idea of payback. Amen. He says in 2016, I can expect repayment. I can expect to be paid back for all the times I stood and it appeared the result was lost. I'm going to get paid back for that. I'm going to get repaid for that. Amen. See, these all build on the other one. Restoration is that return to wholeness, that return to completeness. We took those Sunday mornings and taught on that. It carries the idea of wholeness, of completeness. Well, I've got to have restoration for there to begin to be recompense. A wholeness so God can start paying back. Amen. See, He's not paying back because He owes you. He's paying back because it was stolen or lost. Big difference. When you read through the Old Testament, why was God so adamant about giving back, paying back when something was stolen? He demanded that the person that stole it, if they were caught, that they pay it back. Why was God so adamant about that? When he said, an eye for an eye, tooth for a tooth, smiting for smiting. Why did he say that? Well, it wasn't God getting back. It was this idea of wholeness. That's why Jesus used it this way. He said, you've heard it said, an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth. He said, but here's what I'm saying. If somebody does you wrong, pray for them. It's not any more revenge. It's not getting them back. It's not, you took mine, so I'm going to take yours. It's this idea of wholeness. When something was stolen from somebody in the Old Testament, God said, I want it paid back because I don't want that person to be unwhole. I want them to be complete. And he said, not only do you have to restore to them, you have to add to it. So it's restored, and then I'm paid back for what was taken from me. So God is restoring us, but now he's going to pay us back for what was stolen. It's this concept of repayment or payback in Luke chapter 14. And I intentionally am using references all from the four Gospels or the New Testament. Verse 12. Then said he also to him that bade him, when you make a dinner or a supper, call not your friends nor your brethren, neither your kinsmen nor your rich neighbors, lest they also bid thee again, and a recompense be made thee. But when you make a feast, call the poor, the maimed, the lame, and the blind, and you shall be blessed. Notice, for they cannot recompense you. You shall be recompensed at the resurrection of the just. Now we're still getting this idea. This word recompensed here, it means repay. They can't repay you. Listen, I know this sounds elementary. There's nobody in your life that can make up the difference of what was stolen. There's no person that can make up the difference from what was lost or stolen. God has to do it. Right? So it carries this idea again of repayment. The God's Word translation says, then you will be blessed because they don't have any way to pay you back. You will be paid back when those who have God's approval come back to life. So notice the context again. It's repayment. Restitution and recompense are repayment. When we deal with recompense, we're talking about being paid back for what was stolen. That's the picture you've got to get. What has been stolen? I can expect payback. What has been lost? I can expect payback. He's restoring me and paying me back. Now, this may not be impacting you the way it's impacting me, but I will have mine. I will be restored and I will be recompensed. In the earth this year. I'll see it. You'll see it. You'll see it in my life. You'll see it all over me. You'll see it in every area of my life. I'll have it. Because that's what God promised me. Do you understand that? There are people you know and I know. This is not going to happen to them. And it's not going to happen to them because they're not going to put any faith pressure on it. When you make a determination, I'm getting paid back for everything that was lost or stolen this year. It's coming back to me. Now you're in a position to receive it. it's coming back in Jesus' name. The Living Bible says, then at the resurrection of the godly, God will reward you for inviting those who can't repay you. So we see this idea of repayment, payback, and reward. Now notice that God is the one that's going to repay, payback, and reward. See, God doesn't forget. God does not have short-term memory loss. Nothing goes unnoticed. No good deed that you could do goes unnoticed. When people do you wrong, God doesn't forget that. I'm going to read you a verse in a minute. He doesn't forget. He takes the wrongdoing by others to his people very serious. And he said, I will repay. See, we want to be on the end of the repayment that we're on. We don't want to be on the end of the other repayment. Right? Look at 2 Thessalonians chapter 1 and verse 6. 2 Thessalonians chapter 1 and verse 6. Hallelujah. Now I want you to get this tonight. Seeing it is a righteous thing with God to recompense tribulation to them that trouble you. Now, two things I want to point out. Is this New Testament? So God says it is a righteous thing that when people trouble you, they get recompense of trouble. Wait a minute. From God. Yeah, but God doesn't have anything bad. Yeah, but he can only pay back what seed's been sown. If you sow criticism, you get criticism. If you sow unforgiveness, you get unforgiveness. Now, I'm showing you the concept here. The Amplified Bible says it's a fair decision. Since it's a righteous thing with God to repay with distress and affliction those who distress and afflict you. Now, what's the concept that we get here? What's the idea that we get here? It is fair for God to repay you. It was unfair for you to have that stolen from you. God says it's fair to repay you. It's righteous and it's just for him to repay you. When a person living in sin falls under the judgment of God, it's completely just. Why? Because God's completely just. I've had people say, well, you know, it just doesn't seem fair. You know, God seems to bless some people and doesn't bless some other people. No, God's just. He blesses every person equally. He said, even in the Old Testament, he said, or in Paul's writings, he said, the sun rises and sets on the just and the unjust. The rain falls on the just and the unjust. Everybody's got an opportunity to be blessed by God. Some won't take it. Some won't receive it. Amen. When a person is walking without what they need, when a person is walking in an area where things are not going the way they need them to go back to this every time. God is just. He's not the one that is at fault. Amen. So I've got to go back and understand God is just in his dealings. So he says it's perfectly just and fair that I recompense you for what was lost or stolen. Amen. Another translation says, after all, it's right for God to pay back the one making trouble for you with trouble. It's right for God to pay you back for what was lost or stolen. That's the concept you've got to see. It's right for God to do that. Not that you feel bad about God blessing you, but God's saying, I want to do it because it's right. It's the right thing to do. Now, think about that. What has been lost and what has been stolen? See, I don't know. I've been calculating. Okay, Lord, what has been lost in my life? What has been stolen? So you can't measure it just in monetary value. In your family, what has been lost in your family? How many years of peace have been lost because of something? Payback is coming. Recompense is coming. Because God is just. And I cannot talk about the blessings of God in my life if I'm not talking about this concept of recompense. Because God cannot, because of His justness, allow a debt to be left owing by Him. Amen. So He said, the concept that we see here is when somebody keeps giving you trouble, they're incurring a lien. Amen. And they're going to get paid back. Because God pays back. He repays. That's no reason for you to go out and say, now God's going to get you for that. No, no, no. Amen. Now really, right through here, I'm just trying to get you this concept. So these verses are talking about people being repaid for the wrong they do to believers. See, I got a hold of this concept early on. I got a hold of the concept early on that no one wants to be my enemy. Because you can't successfully be my enemy. It's better for you if you like me. Now, I don't mean that you can't dislike me, but it's better if you don't form weapons against the righteous. That would be any of you. Why? Because they start forming weapons, and God said, I'll get involved. You know what He said? No weapon formed against you shall prosper, and every tongue that rises against you in judgment, you shall condemn it. He said, this is the heritage, the right, the covenantal right of the servants of God, of the righteousness of God. That's us. Amen. The Bible says the Lord, we always talk about, you know, God is love and He is. But you know what the Bible also says about God? It says the Lord is a man of war. When God needs to strap on some equipment, He has no trouble doing that. He's a man of war. And He says right here, I will repay them. If they give you trouble, I'll repay them. But He's also saying, if you've lost something through ignorance or it's been stolen from you, this year, I'm going to repay you. This year. Should I come back here and make that plain? This year. This is the year for that. Amen. Do you understand that? There are people in here already. You've already seen restoration. There's already been restoration. Recompense is following this. This year is quickly getting by us. We are at the end of the fourth month of this year. That means we have 8 more months in this year. Now God wants us to build on this, because whether or not I move into restoration, recompense, and release, this year is going to affect 2017 and 2018 and 2019. I've got to enter into all of it. There are things that God wants to restore. There are debts that have been owed you for years that the enemy stole from you or that you lost through ignorance. And your God, the just God of all the earth, is saying, this year, I want to pay you back for it. Glory be to God. Amen. Do you understand that? I'm going to pay you back. These verses, again, show us the principle of recompense. You don't go around talking and praying for God to recompense somebody evil for you because they did you wrong. He said if they did you wrong, pray for them. Bless them. Amen. Leave that to God. Listen, you'll never do good yourself being a party to someone else's failure. You let God take care of that. But the principle that we're dealing with is that of repayment. If a person just keeps doing wrong, they'll get repaid for that. But guess what? If a person just keeps doing right and it appears that there was loss, they'll get repaid for that. God leaves no debts unpaid. He will not be owable to anyone. Am I helping you? Tell your neighbor, I believe this year you shall be recompensed. Now, I don't know what this means, but he said to come over here and tell you something. If you can lose $10,000 in an hour, you can get $10,000 in an hour. And it doesn't matter how much you need or when you need it. It's just a matter of time before it gets to you. So whatever denomination, you put the number on it. If it can be lost in a certain amount of time, it can be gained in a certain amount of time. And he's going to show you how easy this is going to be. It's getting easier every day, and it's just going to get easier. Because I'm going to reiterate something to you. You are still going to be the richest man in the history of your family. And you have walked the halls of that place where you live more than, or where you work more than once. And you have told the Lord how appreciative you are for Him bringing things into your life. But you've also told the Lord if He would make a way for you to not be on that job, how much you would give into the ministry and how much you would help your pastor and how much you would go and do. And the Lord says, I'm going to answer that prayer. I'm going to answer that prayer, not just for that reason, but you're going to be a major influence in the life of that grandbaby. And don't you worry one bit. Don't you worry one bit. Mom and Dad are both going to be saved, and that child will be raised in the house of God. Glory be to God. Glory to God. Glory to God. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Glory be to God. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Glory be to God. I believe God. I believe God. I believe God. I believe God. Hallelujah. 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 Recompense. As quick as it was lost, it can come back. As fast as it was gone, it can show back up. Why? Because that's payback. It doesn't take any time at all for somebody to just walk up and put the money in your hand that they borrowed from you. Here, I borrowed this from you. I want to pay you back. God's about to tell you, get your hand out because I'm about to pay you back. I'm about to recompense you. I'm about to repay you for all those times you stood and it appeared the result was lost. It's all coming back. And it shall all come to pass. Glory be to God. It shall all come to pass. Why? Because God is a God of recompense. Glory be to God. Glory be to God. Glory be to God. Carl, I'm just going to tell you, it doesn't matter if it's always been that way. God's not interested or concerned about how it's always been. He wants you looking at what's going to be. And every day you get up out of your bed and you declare what you want. You don't declare what is. You declare what you want. You tell God what you want and it shall surely come to pass. Glory to God. Glory to God. Glory to God. Glory to God. Oh, glory to God. Amen. 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 It'll surely come to pass. Yeah, they took that job. They just shut the place down. Job where you had put years in. Job that you worked faithfully on. And they just shut it down. Now, they did you right as much as they wanted to. They blessed you a little bit. Gave you a little porridge. Right? But it still wasn't enough for all the years you put in working faithfully. Well, get ready, because you didn't settle. I'm going to pay you back. See, if we settle, payback doesn't come. Are you following me? If I loaned you $500 and you come to me and you say, Pastor, I can only give you $250. Now, you got to understand, if that was really me and you, I'd probably say, okay. But let's pretend, well, let's not even use me, because I'm not mean like that. So let's say you loan somebody else $500, somebody loans you $500. And you come to them and say, I've only got $250. And they say, okay, I'll take that. And then they go around talking, telling everybody how you didn't give them back all their money. No, you offered them $250 and they took it. They settled for half of what they could have gotten. They have no reason to complain. If you settle, you have nothing to go to God about. This is the year of payback. This is the year of repayment. This is the year of payoff. Don't you settle for one ounce, whatever it is. Don't you settle for three kids saved and one not. Don't you settle for a better marriage. Don't you settle for part of my money back. Don't you settle for part of the picture being clear. It's all going to be clear. It's all coming back. It's all on the way. It shall all come to pass. Glory to God. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Do it again. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Glory to God. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. 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 Where's some of my other little kids? Some of y'all other little kids, serious, you want to run? Some of y'all want to run? Kids, y'all want to run? Come on, get out here and take off. Get out here and take off. Hallelujah. Take off. Take off. Take off. Take off. Glory to God. Glory to God. Glory to God. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. If y'all want to run, run. Just run. Just, oh, glory to God. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Hallelujah. 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 Glory be to God. Glory be to God. Hallelujah. 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 Glory be to God. Hallelujah. You say, Pastor, why you do that? I want them to know something. It's not just us that can run. Anytime we're running, y'all want to take off and run, take off. Hallelujah. Amen. Why? Because it's recompense. Everything that affects mom and dad is going to affect them. Everything that affects grandma and grandpa is going to affect them. I'm telling you what, your kids are going to be healed. Your kids are going to be saved. Your kids are going to be prosperous. Your kids are going to be overwhelmingly blessed. Why? It's the year of the payoff. It's recompense. Glory to God. Glory to God. Glory to God. That's right. That's right. Glory, 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 glory. Glory, 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 glory. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Woo, glory. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. It's all coming back. It's all coming back. Hallelujah. 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 All that peace you lost, all those days that you had to deal with attitudes and had to literally pray in the Holy Ghost, is either pray in the Holy Spirit or smack somebody. Amen. Amen. Made it hard on you. Robbed you of your peace. Couldn't enjoy what you were doing. It's all coming back. It's all coming back. It's all coming back. Hallelujah. Because you mark my words. That's not only just going to be mellow and at peace, it's going to turn into more of what it is right now. They're looking at you more as a leader. They're looking at you more as a business mind, but they're going to see it even clearer. Don't you let up the pressure. Don't you let up the pressure on what you're doing. Recompense is on the way. Hallelujah. 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 As quick as I got you a better job, they anybody else, they'd have fired them. You hear what I'm saying? Anybody else, it had just been too bad. But it couldn't be for you. Because there's a protective coating on you. Ha, 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 ha. And you believe God. You believe God. And everything that you touch is going to keep being blessed. And you get ready. It doesn't matter what the MRI said. It doesn't matter what the test said. That can change. And it's changing now in Jesus' name. Glory be to God. Glory be to God. Glory be to God. I have a feeling. Glory be to God. Glory be to God. Glory be to God. Recompense. It shall all come to pass. As quick as it turned one way, it's going to turn the other way. Amen. 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 Do you see that? Because God's going to recompense you. He said, the righteous shall be recompensed in the earth. The righteous shall be recompensed in the earth. That's me. Payback's on the way. Payoff is on the way. It's coming. It's got my name on it. I don't know when, but I'm ready. I don't know what day it's going to show up, but it's going to show up. I don't know if it's going to be in increments or if it's going to show up in one lump sum. But I don't care however it shows up. It's just going to show up. And when it shows up, I'm going to know it's payback time. It's the payoff. It is the recompense. It shall all come to pass. Glory be to God. Glory be to God. Hallelujah. Are you receiving tonight?
Yes.
Glory be to God. Amen. Amen. Yeah, but somebody did me this way. Payback, it's coming. Recompense is coming. See, God wants to recompense you. He's not concerned with whether they understand it. He wants you recompensed. That person tried to stop you from being happy. But payback's coming. You know what that means? You're going to be happier than you've ever been. You're going to be more joyful than you've ever been. And when y'all walk down the aisle, and I look at you, and I say, Rusty, kiss your bride. That's just the beginning of what God's going to do in your life. I'm helping you tonight. God's helping you. I know the Lord's saying a lot of things. Listen, I've lost the fear of God saying supernatural things through me. I used to hold back and say, Lord, I don't know if I want to say it just that way. I mean, that's big. Lord, what if that don't come to pass? I'm just the messenger boy. I'm Fox News. I report, you decide. I'm just in charge of giving you the news. Whether you believe it's the news or not, it's up to you. Are you following me? I say, are you following me? Woo-hoo-hoo. Yeah, there it is, 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 there it is. Oh, glory. Thank you, Jesus. You're going to start acting more like your pastor than you think is possible. And it's going to start in your spirit. Lord, let the same spirit of faith that's on me be in his life. Now. It's all going to come to pass in Jesus' name. Oh, ha, 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 I had to go through a totally different avenue. I had to go through a totally different avenue to bring what I brought into your life. But look what I did. I caused somebody else to get blessed so they can bless you. Somebody else got blessed and they thought they were doing it out of their own mind. It wasn't out of their own mind. I dropped that in their spirit and I had you in mind when I asked them to do it. And you need to be grateful that even though they may not be walking in the 100% truth that you know they could walk in, they were at least sensitive enough to hear me lead them. And because of that, you got blessed. Now, I moved them to bless you. Now, I can do that on any level. I can do that on any level. I can do that on your job. I can do that in your body. I can do that in your family. I can move it. In a split second of time, your sister can find out she needs to be saved and be born again. In a moment of time, that medicine that you're taking can start to reverse the effects. It can start, you can say, oh, this is not feeling right anymore. In a moment of time, you can go in there and they'll say, this is why it's not feeling right anymore. You're healed. Hallelujah. 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 Glory to God. That's just what you said. You said, well, Lord, what about Floyd? Well, what about Floyd? He's not Mount Rushmore. He's not made of granite. He can change. So right now, give me your hand. Father, we just come into agreement. Floyd will change. Now, Lord, I don't know what he needs to change in. I don't know what he needs to change. But she said, what about Floyd? And you told me to tell her Floyd could change. So we just agree Floyd's going to change. Floyd is going to change. Ho, 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 ha, 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 ha. In the name of Jesus. Recompense. I'm not even going to get back to these notes. Recompense.
Amen.
Ha ha ha. Ha ha ha. Ha ha. Oh, glory. Oh, glory. Now, there's some things going on back here. Hallelujah. Ha ha ha. Thank you, Jesus. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Well, Lord, yeah, hallelujah. Well, glory be to God. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Oh, glory to God. Glory be to God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Glory be to God. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. If you'll just get up and take 3 laps, you'll have the victory by the time you hit 3. Glory to God. Glory to God. Oh, glory. That's it. That's it. That's it. That's it. That's it. Oh, glory. Oh, glory. Oh, glory. Oh, glory. Oh, glory. Hallelujah. 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 Here comes three. Glory to God. Hallelujah. 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 Oh, glory. Hallelujah. Shh. Hallelujah. See, now I'm watching my time tonight, but I'm letting the Holy Spirit move. I want you to understand something. It's not just about being emotional. Ha 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 ha. Ha 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 ha. Ha 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 ha. You understand? It's in the yielding. When I yield to what the Holy Spirit's telling me, I open the door for this payback, for this repayment into my life. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. That's why sometimes in the morning, you just got to get in your living room and dance. You just got to get in your living room and shout before the Lord. Why? I believe what you're saying is going to come to pass. You know why people are so quick to shout in church? Because they're quick to shout at home. What you won't do in private, you don't do in church. You won't do it in church if you don't do it in private. Amen. Do you understand that? It's not just in the running. It's not just in the dancing. It's not just in the shouting. Amen. There are people that do that in the flesh, and I understand that. But when somebody's yielding to the Holy Spirit, there are doors that open that cannot be shut. There are things that begin to transpire in the realm of the Spirit that the enemy cannot stop, because he has no avenue into the Holy Spirit. He has no avenue into the yielding of the Holy Spirit. When you refuse to yield to Him and you yield to the Holy Ghost, He has nothing to say about what God's going to bring into your life. Hallelujah. Recompense. Payback. Repayment. It's coming. It's coming. It's coming. I'm telling you, it's coming. Amen. Amen. It's coming in people. It's coming in people. Hallelujah. It's coming in honor. It's coming. For those times that you were honorable to people that were dishonorable, payback's coming. The Lord told me one time, am I helping you with this? A person had done me wrong. I won't even go into what, I've not talked about it much publicly, and I won't. They'd done me wrong. They'd done me much harm. And I was praying about it one day. And they were talking. They were calling people. They were lying on me. I mean lying. Trying to get people to leave my church. And you know, it didn't help that I'd done nothing but good to these people. I mean finances over and over again. I would take them money, knowing how they felt about me. But God told me to take them money. One day I had somebody give me a $100 bill. And you know, it's always, you know, no matter how many of them you have, it's always nice to have one in your pocket. Right? I mean, you might have seen a bunch of them, but it's always good to have one. Man, I had that $100 in my pocket, and Pastor Michelle had got back from Arkansas, and we were going to go out on the bike. You know, we had a dental appointment, dental cleaning, and we had set up, you know, we're going to take the bike out and ride over to the dentist, and so we did, and then we're going to go eat breakfast and, you know, First Watch and just enjoy our day off. And I had that $100 bill in my pocket. You know, I was just going to use it and just spend the money. I have swiped the card, you know. And on the way over, the Lord said, take that money by this person's house and give it to them. And tell them I just want to bless them. I told my wife that, and I could tell by the look on her face. See, after you're married a while, you begin to think alike. When you got married, you were one flesh, but you weren't one mind. And it's when you became one mind that your marriage really got good. All right? Amen. So some of you, if you're struggling with marriage right now, you're beginning to think alike. Amen. And you'll start thinking, and I know what you're thinking. Dear God, you mean I'm going to think like him? Yes, you are. Amen. And he's going to think like you, and then your marriage will get better. Amen. Hallelujah. But anyway, I could tell by what she was thinking. I could tell by the look on her face. Here's what she's thinking. The same thing I was thinking. You mean I got to give him my money? I didn't want to do that, because I knew something was up. And I took the money by this person's house, and we had went to the dentist and came back, and we took the route by their house, and I stopped and got off and went and knocked on the door. I'd called them to see if they were going to be home, and I knocked on the door, and they opened the door, and I just walked in. This is just my personality. I said, well, the Lord told me to come and give you this. And I'll never forget the person. They looked at me and very, very sternly, or I should say very pridefully, they said, I receive in Jesus' name. Not thank you, not pastor, that's great. Well, you know, I'm mature, at least I like to think I am. And so we left. And so these are the kind of things that I had done. Now, I'm not bragging on me. The Lord had told me to do them. And I was out on my patio one day, and I was praying. Because I just got a notice that they had called somebody and was talking all this junk. And have you ever done this? If you haven't, God bless you. But I said, Lord, I want to tell people how right I am. I'm right. Lord, I haven't done anything. I'm right here. And the Lord said something to me. He took me back to the conversation. And I told this person, I said, I will not discuss this in depth. Now, I'm using vague terms here. In depth, publicly, I will not do it. I will not discuss publicly what you did, what you said, or the way you've done things. And the Lord took me back to that conversation. And he said, Philip, you are honorable. And he said, you must be honorable even to dishonorable people. You understand? There was a deficit on my part there. Now, God has restored everything. You understand? But here's the point. You guess what? That honor that was taken from me, it's coming back. Amen. Why? Recompense. All the times that you forgave and walked in love and people took your forgiveness and your love walk and walked on it and just treated you like you should have done that for them, that's coming back to you. It's coming back to you. Amen. All the times you did the right thing when it was easier to do the wrong thing, that's coming back to you. How do I know that? That's what God told me. It's not just finances. It's not just money. That may be the biggest thing you need recompense in. But think about that. Every time you did right and somebody snuffed at it, somebody just acted like it was nothing, God's going to pay you back for that. That's why I'm telling you, all that peace you lost is coming back to you in heaping loads. Tony, I'm going to say this to you. This is what the Lord told me to tell you. All that peace of mind that you lost in them days and them months and that long periods of time that you were running from the Lord, that's coming back to you. Brother, the fog's going to lift. You got to stay up under the Word. You got to stay coming to church and stay under the preaching of the Word, and God's going to renew your mind. You just stay with it. I'm going to tell you like Jesus told the scribe. The scribe came to him and asked him a question. And Jesus said, what's the first commandment? He said, love the Lord your God with all your heart, your soul, your mind. And Jesus looked at that scribe and said, you're not far from the kingdom of God. I'm telling you, son, you keep seeking and you keep searching. You're not far. Glory to God. Glory to God. You keep listening. You put down your pride and you listen to people that know more than you, and God will change your life. Hallelujah. Glory be to God. It's all coming back. I say it's all coming back. It shall all come to pass. It shall all come to pass. Let me finish with this. When, just for the sake of time, because I want to be cognizant of this, look very quickly. Actually, guys, would you just do me a favor and put this on the screen for me. Ruth chapter 2. And I want to look at verse 11 and 12. Now I'm going to hurry through this. I showed you, do you get the concept of recompense? Do you see it? This is when Ruth went to Boaz. Notice this. I want to show you the loss here first. Verse 11 shows us the loss. Boaz answered her, said, it's fully been shown to me all you've done to your mother-in-law since the death of your husband, and how you've left your father and your mother in the land of your nativity. Now, hang on right there. Keep that up there for just a moment. You remember that Naomi and her husband left Bethlehem and went into another country because there was a famine, right? Well, while they were there, their sons married Orpah and Ruth. All right? Well, then while they were there, their husbands died. Dad died and the two boys died. The Bible says that Naomi's, the other daughter, went back to her family. And Ruth said, no, I'm not going to do that. Remember, you've heard the song probably. You know the song more than the scripture. Wherever you go, I'll go. Your people will be my people. Your God will be my God. So she didn't go back to her family, her father and her mother, which is what she could have done. And they would have taken care of her because she was a widow. Her husband had died. She chose to suffer loss to do the right thing. Now look at verse 12. The Lord recompense your work and a full reward be given you of the Lord God of Israel, under whose wings you are come to trust. Whew. That word recompense there, hallelujah. It is again, it's that word, shalem. It means simply this: full, just, complete, or whole. A whole reward. And that word reward, it means wages or a reward. So all the wages, Ruth, that you lost to do the right thing, the Lord's going to reward you back. And not just a reward, a full reward. A whole reward. A recompense. A complete payback. She did the right thing, and it appeared the result was loss. And God said through Boaz, I'm not just going to make it better for you because of what you've done. I'm going to give you a recompense. In other words, I'm going to pay you back, but it's not just going to be a payback, it's going to be a full payback. God doesn't pay you back 10 cents on the dollar. He gives you a full reward. See, that's coming to you this year. How do I know that? He promised. And God cannot lie. See, let me close with this. Regardless of what you believe about, and I know you're faith builders, so you believe what the Lord says prophetically, but regardless of what you believe about that, you've got to see the concept in the Word of God. That's what God wants to do. If God wants to recompense the evil for the evil that they've done, the reciprocal of that is God wants to recompense the just for the good they've done. It's the law of reciprocals. I've got a teaching on that, the law of reciprocals. Every good thing you do, there's a good thing coming your way. That's not mind over matter. That's not thinking a good thought. That's Bible law. Amen. All the pain that you went through physically, standing in faith, and there were even times it seemed it didn't work, you're going to get paid back for that. Now, I don't know how all that works, but here's what I do know. You're not going to know that you could feel that good. I mean, how good do you have to feel to not know you could feel that good? Amen. Amen. Who's been having chest pains in here? A couple of you? Come up here. If you've been having chest pains. Hallelujah. Now you've been standing in faith. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Ha 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 ha. It's going to go. Got to go. Got to go. So manese ki namande ge ne maha. Go namande ge de basa. Whoop. Bris nama. There, that just went in. Yep. There it goes. Now, they'll not come again. They'll not come again. Hallelujah. Lord, as a servant of the Most High God, standing in the office that you've called me to, Lord, the office of this woman's pastor, I tell you, it'll not come again. In the name of Jesus. It'll not come again. It'll not come again. Glory be to God. Amen. Hallelujah. Matter of fact, if you've been fighting any physical junk, now remember, we're fighting it. We're not just suffering through. We're standing against it. If that's you, I don't care what it is. Whatever it is. Now, amen. Well, come on. You started coming, so come on. Hallelujah. Glory be to God. Glory be to God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. So raman de ge sekina man de gaya. Go ram rang rebe si. Rob bre sikin da bang de sekina man de gaya. Go ram rang rebe sekehe. Go ta sikana mando garabasika. Re sikana mando garia siki. Ro bre sihehe. Ho zeme kene mando go rebre seke. Father, as these people's pastor, I lay hands on them, and in the name of Jesus, loosen, 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 loosen in the office that I'm called to. Loosen. There it goes. There it goes. Loosen in the office that I'm called to. Go and don't come back. Go and don't come back. In the office I'm called to. Go and don't come back. In the office I'm called to. Go and don't go. All inflammation, all burning, all pain, all stabbing pain. Go. Go. In the office I stand in, go and don't come back. In the office I stand in, go and don't come back. In the office I stand in, you go and don't come back. Go and don't come back. In the office that I'm standing in, go and don't hurt. Sombre stike. Go and don't come back. Go and don't come back. So raman de gese kerebasi. Zo marebre si karabasuka. Rembre grebe se kerebese. Go and don't come back. Go and don't come back. Se ma do bre si pa. Go and don't come back. Go and don't come back. Go. Wow, that just flowed heavy into you, Mama. Hallelujah. My Lord and my God. Well, go ahead. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Go and don't come back. In the office I stand in, go and don't come back. In the office I stand in, go and don't come back. Go and don't come back. Go and don't come back in Jesus' name. Thank you, Jesus. So ram rang re bre si kata ma re bre. Go and don't come back. Go and don't come back. Ha ha ma se ke ma ha. O ma na ma se ka na mandege si karabasa. O rabasa ke ne manda rabasaka. Mark, 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 mark. Mark, 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 mark. That's what I said. Well, how would you want me to say it? Mark her with a mark that cannot be erased. Hallelujah. And when I say this, don't worry about what it is. The plan for your life is good. The plan for your life is great. The plan for your life is peace. The plan for your life is joy. Just keep following me. I'm not worried about you being so vocal about it. I'm not worried about you just telling everybody you know about what God's telling you. Girl, just keep following me. In Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Both of y'all are just her. In the name of Jesus, as this child's pastor, Lord, I stand in that office. You go and you back in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Is this young man's pastor? You go. You go. I know. That's the anointing. Isn't that something? Hallelujah. That blesses me. Hallelujah. You go and don't come back. Hallelujah. Praise God. Is this pastor? This man's pastor. You go and don't come back. You go and don't come back. Yeah, Lord, and reveal those hidden things to him. Lord, reveal those hidden things, those things that he's seeking about, those things that he's diligent to ask you about. Lord, what he don't know, he will know. The hidden things shall be revealed, and they will be revealed in due time. They will be revealed in a cycle. They'll come, Lord. Yeah, I'll say it just that way. They'll come, and they'll start coming little bit by little bit, and you'll get some information, and you'll get tidbits of information. Then you'll start seeing more, and then you'll start seeing more, and then you'll see the whole. then you'll see the whole. Don't get ahead of me. I'm showing you the plan. Keep walking it out. Amen. Glory be to God. Hallelujah. I believe God. I believe God. Ha, ha, ha. Whew. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Thank the Lord. Hallelujah. Praise God. Praise God. Praise God. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I certainly do not want to be frivolous, but that's all I got. So let's stand up tonight. Praise the Lord. Amen. Glory be to God. Amen. Like the man said, if that's it, just stop. Hallelujah. Glory be to God. Amen. Now, I'm telling you, the Lord has given me this phrase, and I use it all the time. When the enemy, and you got to understand, I don't give the enemy credit. I'm not one of those people that hears the devil talking all the time. Amen. Because after you jab him with that sword of the Spirit in his mouth enough, he quits running his mouth. But if he starts talking to you, you just answer him this way. It shall all come to pass. It will all come to pass. What the Lord has said to me, well, it will all come to pass. That's just the way it is. Amen. Why? Because God said. Amen. Do you believe that? Well, take the hand of your neighbor tonight. We appreciate you. You are the best church in the world. You truly are. I'm telling you what, I'm not the person that uses the word proud a lot. Because, I mean, but when I do, I say I'm godly proud. I am godly proud of this church. Now, I know it's the Holy Spirit, and I mean, I know God is doing this, but you got to understand something. You can't teach people how to be good people. The Holy Spirit has to do that. And you are honoring of the anointing. You are honoring of the gift and the calling on me and my wife. And that's why you always receive impartation. Because when you're willing to walk in honor, the anointing gravitates towards honor. And when you're willing to honor, God will bless you. Amen. So I mean that. You are prayed for. We love you. We think the world of you. You're the best people in the world. I couldn't ask for a better church. Amen. And I want you to know that you mean the world to me. So, amen. If you ever think nobody likes you, I like you. Praise God. Hallelujah. So tell your neighbor, the vision of our church will always be to build people's faith and frame their world by the word of God. You and I will always be world changers. Now let me share this with you just before we go. Gentlemen, this Friday at 7 p.m., we've got our men's conference. Amen. And we're going to be having some wonderful times here in the presence of the Lord. Our praise team has graciously agreed to come and lead worship for us. So we're going to have an awesome time. And then Saturday morning, we'll meet at 8 a.m. for breakfast. Breakfast will be $8. Amen. And it'll be a good, filling breakfast. Amen. You understand? It's not like, how much? 9 o'clock? Yolanda has corrected me publicly. Daryl says, I know how you feel. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. But and buses are clean. Praise God. 9 o'clock, we will be there. Amen. Hallelujah. We'll be here at 9 o'clock for breakfast. You can show up at 8 for fellowship. Amen, if you would like to. But it'll be a good filling breakfast. Then we will begin at 10 a.m., and again, our worship team will be here. We're going to, now, the Lord has told me this is going to be a time of impartation. And I believe that God brings all of us men together for this season to do these things. And we're going to be talking about honoring our godly heritage. Amen. The Lord has given me some wonderful things to deal with us about. Amen. And so we're going to see great things. Amen. So please be here if at all possible. Bring somebody with you. If you know a friend that maybe doesn't know Jesus or needs to get closer to Jesus, or somebody that needs healing or deliverance from an addiction, just invite them. Tell them you'll buy them breakfast. People will always come to eat. And then once they're here, they're stuck because you're driving. Right? Amen. But then Jesus gets hold of them and they get free. Isn't that good? Amen. So God bless you. We love you guys. We'll see everybody Wednesday night. Men, we'll see you on Friday evening. God bless you.